A surprise lefty, the president tosses out the first ball, and the game is on. Japan, and first pictures of the burned-out shells of its greatest cities. In 44 centers like these, completely devastated by B-29s, the enemy's power to make war was forever smashed. A Jap carrier knocked out by Third Fleet aircraft lies in Koori Harbor near a sunken battleship. But the greatest damage by far was done by a single B-29 carrying the atomic bomb.
This afternoon, a message from the Japanese government in reply to the message forwarded to that government by the Secretary of State on August 11th. I deem this reply a full acceptance of the Potsdam Declaration, which specifies the unconditional surrender of Japan.
Thousands of proud American flags dotted the square, and as the day wore on, hilarity reached a high peak. New York never celebrated like this before, but never did they have a better reason.
Admiral King expresses his feelings to the officers and men of the fleet.
I wish to tell you briefly how I feel about the way you have performed your tasks in this war. The very scope of our victory bears ample testimony to your magnificent courage and teamwork. You are part of the greatest naval force the world has ever seen. To each and every one of you, my congratulations and thanks.
I'm William P. Mack. The story I'm going to tell you is about a resurrection, a comeback story, a story that needs to be told because it's exceptional. He was Fleet Admiral Ernest J. King, U.S. Naval Academy, class of 1901, the height of his naval career arriving at a time when most men retire. He was tough and shrewd, egocentric and arrogant, cruel and kind, a man who loved power. People who worked for him referred to him as Old Ironsides. Shipmates christened him God Almighty and the 12 Apostles. It was Uncle Ernie to others, and just Ernie to President Franklin D. Roosevelt, who appointed King Commander-in-Chief of the U.S. Fleet. Soon after Pearl Harbor was attacked, in the years following, he also became Chief of Naval Operations and the first American naval officer to wear 5 stars. Who was Ernest J. King? What was he? To answer these questions, we must go back in time.
Lorain, Ohio is a busy Lake Erie port near Cleveland. The city prides itself on being an important part of America's production arm. That tradition was evident in Lorain's beginnings. The town was founded in 1807. Shipbuilding emerged around 1820. And heavy industry during the Civil War. In 1872, a Scottish immigrant, James Clydesdale King, came to the United States to begin a new life. His first jobs were aboard sailing vessels on the Great Lakes. Later, he found employment as a bridge builder. Both jobs were nomadic in nature, an existence he enjoyed. until he married Bessie Keem of Cleveland. In 1876, James King became an employee of the Cleveland, Lorain, and Wheeling Railroad, working in the roundhouse at Lorain. 2 years later, Ernest Joseph King was born on November 23, 1878. He was the oldest of five children. There were two girls and three boys. It appears that King was fascinated with boats and the sea at a very young age. The story is told that once when he was seven, King started off to experience sea adventures related to him by his father's uncle. However, as he walked by Uncle Brown's house, the aroma of baking cookies lured him inside. High school was easy for King. He finished in 3 years instead of the usual four. He played end on the football team and graduated valedictorian from Lorain High School in 1897. King was interested in attending the Naval Academy as a very young boy.
Then the Naval Academy really wasn't very well known in the Midwest, but he had read in a magazine that the Naval Academy existed, and one day he said to his dad, "I think I'd like to go there." His dad said, "Fine," and he had to take, he took a competitive exam with 33 other young men from Ohio, and he stood number one, and so he came to Annapolis to start a new life, make his way in the world.
King went to war in 1897, the Spanish-American War. King's first sea duty was with a group of classmates who got themselves aboard the cruiser San Francisco and steamed toward Cuba to join a blockade force. The war ended quickly, and the midshipmen returned to classes in Annapolis. Ernest King excelled as a midshipman. He was active, playing football for the Hustlers, the forerunners of today's junior varsity team, and was active in several organizations. He also became battalion commander.
I think one of the more interesting stories is that when he was a plebe, he was in a room with a classmate named Adolphus Andrews, and a drunken upperclassman came in and said to King, "Hey, King, I understand that you want to be number one here at the Naval Academy." And King said, "Oh, no, I didn't say that." His classmate Adolphus Andrews spoke up and said, "Well, I want to be number one," and the upperclassman just lit into him. And King said he learned a great deal from that. So he decided he would graduate from here number four because it was still at the top of the class, but it made him less conspicuous and people wouldn't be watching us quite as closely.
The Lucky Bag yearbook portrayed King as a man so various that he seems to be not one, but all mankind's epitome. King married Martha Rankin Edgerton of Baltimore in 1905. They had known each other while he was still a midshipman. In 1906, Lieutenant King was assigned as an instructor at his alma mater. His duty was teaching ordnance, gunnery, and seamanship. He also was in charge of marching and infantry maneuvers. After 2 years, King transferred to the executive department as an officer in charge and enforced discipline in Bancroft Hall. There, his reputation was more firmly established.
One night, he was awakened by a Marine orderly who said, "Sir, the midshipmen are throwing things at me." So with that, King broke out the entire battalion of midshipmen and kept them up all night, and he let them secure one class at a time, the plebes first in the second class, and finally on down the first class. That was the last time there were any disciplinary problems when King was here.
King was promoted to lieutenant commander in 1913. He had been in the Navy for more than 13 years and still had not commanded a ship. As the threat of war between the United States and Mexico intensified, King finally was given his first command in 1914, a reserve destroyer, the USS Terry. In his memoirs, King regarded command of the Terry as one of the most important achievements of his career.
Get your gun, take it on the run, on the run, on the run. Hear them calling you and me, every son.
The U.S. became involved in World War I in 1917.
No delay over there.
Now a commander, King was asked to become a member of Vice Admiral Henry T. Mayo's staff. He had learned a lot about war during this time and had dealt with the Navy Department and Washington politicians. He mobilized the fleet and attended conferences with Allied civilian and military leaders. The winds of war had blown well for King. He became a captain and was awarded the Navy's highest award, the Navy Cross. It wasn't until World War I that submarines became prominent in the Navy, and at that, it was a German Kriegsmarine and its devastating use of the U-boat that forever changed sea warfare. The U.S. Navy went to work building more submarines, plus establishing a major base at New London, Connecticut. Most of the submarine candidates in those days were either drafted or induced to volunteer. Most men stayed away from subs. King was an exception. He was curious. By the summer of 1922, the Kings had seven children, six girls and a boy.
When he graduated, he made a bet with one of his classmates as to who would have the first son. And of course, in those days, they had to wait 2 years before they could even marry. So they married, time went by, they both produced children, both daughters. They doubled the bet. Time went by, they both produced daughters again. They doubled the bet. After five times, King still had daughters and his classmate had a son. So Admiral King paid off a large bet. And that didn't satisfy Admiral King. He was still insistent, so he did have a son on the sixth try. Now, he was telling the story himself at a dinner party one night to the lady sitting next to him. And she asked him, "Well, what did you name the boy?" He said, "Why, Ernest Joseph Jr., of course." She said, "Oh, no, Admiral. You should have named him Ernest Endeavor."
In the fall of 1925, a New London-based submarine, the S-51, was rammed by a ship and sank, killing the 37 crew members. King was primarily responsible for its salvage. The S-51 episode made him a famous man, but the silent service was only a stepping stone for King. He had other plans. At age 49, King earned his aviator's wings. He said it also was one of the most important events in his career. The USS Lexington was a first-rate aircraft carrier in 1930. King became her commanding officer that year. He had exact standards for his people. If they failed to improve, they were fired.
He fired navigators at the drop of a hat on the Lexington, and I was assistant navigator, I guess, almost the whole time I was on there, even though I was signal officer part of the time. And as I said in the book, he should have fired me instead of his navigator, but he knew what was going on. He knew what the navigators were doing, but most of the ones at the Bureau of Navigation it was then still was sending, would send him as navigators were these aviators who had been flying these airplanes in World War I, and most of them had lost their hearing. And they were permanent lieutenants, or they were lieutenants, and they were never going any higher. He had sent them out there to be the navigator of the Lexington. Well, they didn't know beans about navigation. Some of them couldn't add. and he'd find out in a hurry. They didn't know what they were talking about. And the minute we'd go to sea, he'd send off a dispatch and get them relieved. And they'd get them sent off the ship. They'd send him another one just like it. He'd fire me in. He must have fired four navigators.
Under King, the fit survived and developed into some of the Navy's finest. The unfit were eliminated.
Yes. Brandenburger was a red-headed Irishman, a little fella, and a very good flight deck officer in spite of King, but he and King tangled frequently. And King was, Captain King was never satisfied that they had the plane spotted right or were moving them fast enough. King was yelling at him from the bridge one day for his job down there, and Brandenburger shook his fist up there and he says, "You're going to take the flight deck and stuff up here." And King yelled down there and says, "If you're not crazy, you better be."
At age 54, and after 35 years of service, it was Rear Admiral King. For some, selection to that rank was a culmination. To King was a beginning. President Roosevelt had just taken office when King took over the Navy's aviation department. It was a grim period for naval aviation, owing to the hardships of the Depression.
tremendous. He was an advocate of aviation. There is no convert so avid as a recent convert. He was not an aviator until he was a captain. The Navy took a lot of people, commanders and captains, sent them to Pensacola, where most of them never became really skillful aviators, but they became ardent proponents of it. They knew a great deal about the theory, although they were not very good plane handlers themselves. And Admiral King was one of those ardent advocates.
King was instrumental in establishing the Naval Aviation Cadet Program, recruiting college graduates to augment the inadequate numbers of Naval Academy aviators. He also was responsible for developing the prototype consolidated PBY Catalina flying boat, the seagoing workhorse of World War II. In January 1938, two things happened to E.J. King. He fleeted up to Commander Aircraft Battle Force and was promoted to Vice Admiral. He was 60 years old.
Und vor allem nicht dort einmarschieren dürfen und ernannt als darf in Frage kommen nun. Finnland, Lettland, Litauen, Estland, Norwegen, Schweden, Dänemark, Niederlande, Belgien, Großbritannien, Irland, Frankreich, Portugal, Spanien, die Schweiz, Liechtenstein, Luxemburg, Polen, Ungarn.
The Great War had already started in Europe and it was escalating. The Axis powers are winning on every front. England was alone and needed help.
The chief of naval operations in 1939 was Admiral Harold R. Stark. King was passed over. No one really knows why, but there were speculations that the admiral drank too much, that he was outnumbered by the surface ship hierarchy, that he was not an intimate of FDR. That year, he received word that he would be ordered to the General Board. It was a place, some said, for aging admirals near retirement. In addition, King was reverted to a permanent rank of rear admiral. The resurrection of Ernest J. King surfaces at about this time. He had served 8 months on the board when Charles Edison, Secretary of the Navy, called on him to lead a guided tour of the fleet. Apparently, Edison took a liking to King.
It was Edison who strongly suggested that King would make an outstanding commander-in-chief for the U.S. fleet. In 1940, Edison retired. FDR did nothing about Edison's endorsement, and nothing until December of 1941. However, in the interim, there were changes in the Navy structure brought on by the new Secretary of the Navy, Frank Knox. He divided the fleet into three separate entities, making King head of the Atlantic Fleet. With that came the quick appointment back to Vice Admiral, and in no time, the full admiral, four stars. Argentia, Newfoundland, August 1941. FDR meets with Winston Churchill. It was called the Atlantic Conference. Discussion centered on the allocation of American-produced war materiel among the U.S., Great Britain, and the Soviet Union. One agreement directly involved King's Atlantic Fleet. That was to escort British merchant ships. The November 24th issue of Life magazine portrayed Admiral King as a tough, aggressive, confident, seagoing flag officer. The public, Life said, could be assured that the Atlantic Fleet was well led.
米国が日本民の入国を禁止して以来、我々は今日という日の国の待っていた。米国人は白人種の優秀性を説いていたが、今度はどちらが優秀民族であるかを知らしめてやる。敏腕賢明なる登場閣下は、白人どもが馬鹿げた矢訴鏡をつける。眠っているものを見て攻撃を開始。我が国の皇軍は百中百発。 米国にについてに日本帝国も届き天皇の上に光栄を米国戦闘艦アリゾナオクラホマペンシルベニアメリーランドウェストバージニアカリフォルニアなどはついに海底の目視と起用万歳万歳。
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God.
The time had come for Ernest J. King. The president promptly appointed King commander-in-chief of the U.S. fleet, a fleet that was in dire need of rejuvenation. The first thing he did was to move to Washington permanently so he could be close to the seat of power. The Admiral lived aboard his flagship Dauntless, moored in the Washington Navy Yard, and pretty much in seclusion. One of his first staff assignments went to Rear Admiral Russell Wilson, then superintendent of the Naval Academy.
But take Russell Wilson. Now, Russell Wilson was superintendent here of the Naval Academy when Admiral King was appointed first commander-in-chief, then CNO. And he set for Russell Wilson, an outstanding admiral with a wonderful record, to come to Washington to be his chief of staff, largely because of Wilson's ability, his mental powers, and so forth, but they never got along. Partly because Admiral Wilson was a kind of Hamlet. He thought only to think things out, analyze them very carefully, and take time. And he felt he'd bring in this carefully reasoned situation, and Admiral King push it aside and make a spot decision. And it finally wore down on Admiral Wilson's health.
Went in to see Admiral Russell Wilson, who was the chief of staff, and he said, Admiral King wants to see you right away. So I went in and said, you sent for me, sir? He said, I did. I want you to go down and relieve Admiral
Layton.
Admiral Layton. And I want you to relieve him this afternoon before 4 o'clock. So I went down there, and of course, Admiral Layton had two captain assistants, both of which were far senior to me, since I was just commander. And I said, I have orders from Admiral King that I am to relieve you, and you are to be out of the office by 4 o'clock this afternoon.
Dickie Edwards, number two man in the U.S. fleet. 4 stars, wakes me up, he says, I want Admiral King to see these dispatches. And I said, I'm sorry, he left orders not to be disturbed. He said, look, and he looked me in the eye, he says, I get 4 stars. You're a lieutenant commander. I'm giving you orders. Wake Admiral King up. Well, hell, not much I could do about it. So I go in, I'm smart enough, you know, don't touch the old man. Flick on a light. Boy, that light went on. He had an eye like an eagle. He had a cold eye, looks at me. He'll walk over, hand him these dispatches. He looks at him. Then he turns to me and roars, now just what in hell am I supposed to do about this at midnight in Washington? What do you think I got Admiral Nimitz out there for? Get out. Well, I knew he wasn't mad at me. This is what. Well, I turned around by the time I got the door. Admiral Edwards was last seen running over the gangway, headed north.
The Americans and British in 1941 suddenly became allies in war, and Roosevelt and Churchill decided to meet again to discuss grand strategy. King didn't say much during the talks, mostly listening to what the British were saying. His relationship with the British was, to say the least, cool.
He apparently, in World War I, when he was chief of staff to Sinclair,
developed something, a typical U.S. Navy love-hate relationship with the British. He was jealous of them. He was envious. He thought the U.S. Navy could do things better. We were newer, more modern, more efficient, less tied to tradition. He brought this into World War II. Among his enemies, he was contemptuous of the British. He thought British strategy in the European theater was foolish. The British had let themselves get caught with their pants down too many times. They'd had their own Pearl Harbors.
In the early morning hours of December 22nd, 1941, some 43,000 troops of the Japanese Imperial Army landed in the Philippines. In spring of 1941, Japan had occupied more than 5,000 miles in each direction of ocean and land from Borneo to the Aleutian Islands. The rising sun appeared with almost no opposition. Air power had been thus far the key to Japan's victories. The menace was the Zero fighter plane, which could outrace and outmaneuver any Allied aircraft when first introduced in 1940 as the Type O carrier-based fighter.
The Japanese were hard fighting. They knew what they were doing. They were skilled and experienced and resolute. And had they been able to dig in, I doubt if we would have had the ability to unseat them. So I think he was personally responsible for our success in the Pacific.
King, immediately after Pearl Harbor, had a fleet. He had to do something with that fleet. He had problems both in the Atlantic and the Pacific. And in 1942, when General Marshall's problem is basically organizing and administrating and training an army, it's really King who is developing what becomes the Grand Pacific Strategy against the Japanese.
Midway in the early summer of 1942 is hailed as one of the greatest naval victories in American history. Drive toward Australia was another story. In early 1942, carrier-borne Japanese planes demolished the northern Australian port of Darwin. In July, Japanese troop ships began landing 14,000 infantrymen on New Guinea, where they planned to stage for a final assault on the southern continent. East of New Guinea are the Solomon Islands and famed Guadalcanal. It was just off Guadalcanal where more than 35 naval battles had been fought. 65 major warships were sunk, roughly half American, half Japanese. The area between Guadalcanal and Savo and Florida Islands became known as Iron Bottom Sound. Architect for the Battle of Guadalcanal was Admiral King. The Army had viewed the Pacific War as a defensive war. The Navy and King felt that the first priority should go to holding what the United States had in the Pacific. So there was frequent clashing.
General Marshall characterized King's relationship with MacArthur as a policy of hatred. King studiously avoided coming in any contact with MacArthur at all during the war. He had several opportunities. One, when MacArthur went to Hawaii to visit Roosevelt, and King very conveniently got out of town just as MacArthur was coming in. He didn't want to have anything to do with him.
There was one occasion during the war when they had to see each other. King refused, and he sent his chief of staff as kind of an envoy. The chief of staff ended up yelling at MacArthur, and MacArthur yelling at him for several hours. It was a fruitless meeting.
Never has a war ever been fought, but in that there wasn't clashes between strong-minded people. People who are any good in war are tough-minded people. They've got to be. And when two of them get together, as they have to get together, there are clashes. But from that, they arrive at a very good method of operation.
Freedom of the press was a sour issue during World War II, and King was not a cooperative person with the media.
The whole concept that we have now in security of need to know is a product of King. This was his byword. This caused an awful lot of public relations problems for the Navy. King always cited the Midway episode as the sort of problem that could erupt from a policy that was somewhat lax than that. What had in fact happened was that an idiot aboard a ship that was coming back from Midway had actually posted a radio communications which referred to the fact that the United States had broken the Japanese code. There's a reporter aboard ship from the Chicago Tribune. He happened to look up at the bulletin board, read this, put it in the headlines in the Chicago paper, and King was furious. He wanted to have the man tried for treason.
The Saturday Evening Post interviewed King and printed an article describing him as 6 feet of lime tart, shadowy rather than mysterious.
He was sufficiently intelligent and sufficiently insensitive so that if he could correct someone, he always took the opportunity to do it, making them look as bad as possible, regardless of whether they were subordinate or superior.
My buzzer rings. Admiral King says, he don't say Admiral Halsey, he says, I want to see Halsey right now. By that time, the Third Fleet was anchored in Aniwita. He didn't tell me how, where, or what to. I just called the phone, called the chief personnel, and said, Admiral King wants to see Admiral Halsey right now. Again, Jacob says, starts the sputter. I says, you know Admiral King. He means now. 3 days later, Halsey pops in. Hi, Dusty, how are you? I'm here to see Admiral King. And he says, I'll go right in. I says, just a minute, I better tell Admiral King. I think I knew what was going to happen. So I go in. I says, Admiral King, Admiral Halls is here. And normally King would go out and meet him. He says, show him in. I go, oh boy, here it comes. Well, a four-star admiral goes in to see a five-star admiral. And I'm telling you, gets bawled out. You could hear him all over the second floor, the Navy Department. Admiral King took him from up there, down there. There was no foul language, but was it solid? You goddamn stupid son of a bitch. And he read him up and down. I think King would have relieved him, but Halsey was such a popular character. He could.
King managed to get away from Washington occasionally. His favorite place of respite was Annapolis, where at times he supported the events at the Academy. His son, Ernest Jr., was a midshipman, and this also gave King an excuse to visit the Chesapeake community. In 1943, King addressed the graduating class in Dahlgren Hall.
...611 midshipmen graduate one full year ahead of time. Fleet Commander Admiral King urges cooperation for victory.
Take all proper pride in the prestige and power of the Navy, but do not forget that other great armed service, the United States Army, also wears the uniform of our country, as do our fellow services of the Navy, the Marine Corps, and the Coast Guard. Do not allow yourselves to become prejudiced because another wears a different uniform and is skilled in the use of different weapons.
In November of 1943, major units of the U.S. fleet penetrated into the Central Pacific. Their objective, to seize the Gilbert Islands. The target was Tarawa, a tiny atoll the Japanese had occupied 2 days after Pearl Harbor. Tara was like a fortress. The Japanese had mined its reefs and placed huge shore batteries on its beaches. And more than 100 machine gun nests zeroed in on the invading Allies. Prior to the landing, Rear Admiral Raymond A. Spruance's 17 warships pounded the shore with roughly 10 tons per acre of high explosives, while 5,000 Japanese soldiers lay waiting. Fighting was ferocious. The battle officially ended 76 hours later with a casualty list of more than 3,000 Marines. Few hundred Japanese survivors.
King was not unaware of the fact that the American people did not agree with the strategy of Germany first, after Pearl Harbor particularly. They were incensed with the Japanese. They wanted to get back at the Japanese. Revenge for Pearl Harbor kept the war momentum going. And someone in Washington had to be somewhat sensitive to this, and King was the most sensitive to it.
At dawn on June 13, 1944, King sent 112 U.S. warships into the Philippine Sea, among them seven battleships and 15 aircraft carriers carrying nearly 1,000 warplanes. Transports held over 125,000 fighting men. The task force's mission was to capture the Marianas Islands of Guam, Tinian, and Saipan. The so-called Marianas turkey shoot, where the Japanese were uprooted and demoralized, King made a personal visit to the islands. It was the first time he had traveled beyond Pearl Harbor into the front lines. He told his aides that he wanted to show himself to his troops in the battle zone.
Ladies and gentlemen, we interrupt this program to bring you a special broadcast.
This is George Hicks speaking. I'm now speaking from the tower above the signal bridge of an American naval flagship. And we're lying some few miles off the coast of France, where the invasion of Europe has begun. It is now 20 minutes to 6.
The year 1944 was eventful for the Allies. On June 6th, Americans landed on Omaha and Utah beaches in Normandy. Later that year, on the third anniversary of the attack on Pearl Harbor, Allied forces stood poised to assault the inner defenses of the Japanese Empire.
October 2nd, 1945, the battleship Missouri steams into Tokyo Bay. On the decks of this giant ship, the document that is to reduce Japan to a fifth-rate power is to be signed. Fleet Admiral Chester W. Nimitz, one of the men most responsible for smashing the Japanese hopes for world domination, is piped aboard the Missouri. He is met by Admiral Bull Halsey, the man who translated the brilliant naval strategy of Admirals King and Nimitz into the devastating power that ripped the Jap fleet apart.
We are gathered here, representatives of the major warring powers, to conclude a solemn agreement whereby peace may be restored. I now invite the representatives of the Emperor of Japan and the Japanese government and the Japanese Imperial General Headquarters to sign the instrument of surrender at the places indicated.
Hesitant and nervous, Shigemitsu signs the obituary to 2,605 years of an unbroken dynasty, during which no foreign troops had occupied Japanese soil.
He had great knowledge. He was a stubborn man, but he also knew how to pick people. He was ruthless if somebody failed, as he should be, as he must be. Those are not qualities that endear him to people. Those are qualities which win a war. Those are qualities which hold a nation together.
All I can repeat to you is what I consider one of our great unsung heroes of the war, who few people realize controlled the largest navy the world has ever seen, was very fair, but a tough son of a bitch, and you worked for him, and you were proud to work for him. I wish we had more leaders like him.
Freedom to think for yourself.
To disagree with the government.
Freedom to be equal.
To be different.
Freedom to raise a family.
To marry the man I love.
The freedom to worship the God of my choice.
To live with dignity.
The freedom to be me.
To be whatever I want to be.
Defending freedom for over 200 years.
Hi, I'm General Johnny Wilson, retired U.S. Army, retired at the rank of four-star general. My message today is to ask you to stay in school, to ask you to respect each other, to ask you to pay attention while in school, and to let you know that not only Lorain, but America depends upon you. If America is going to continue to be the leader in the world, we have to have you who will shape the future for us. So I'm counting on you.